Hello, everyone. I'm James Valvano, and welcome to another edition of We Have a Face TV. Today, I have two incredible special guests with us, Dr. Tom Bird and Dr. Herwig Lang. We are all on three different time zones, so I want to thank both of you for joining us. We're going to continue the topic with the current diagnostic criteria and why we believe it should be changed. Let me introduce Dr. Herwig Lang, who is our chief medical advisor. Dr. Lang, welcome to the show.
Pleased to be on the show again.
Yes. And Dr. Bird, thank you so much for joining us all the way from Washington.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Yes. So let's just jump right into this. Everyone is aware of the current initiative that is going on regarding changing the diagnostic criteria. And we all know that there are many questions, there are many concerns. So I want to bring you right in, Dr. Bird, and I want you to talk to our patients, our caregivers, medical professionals, and organizations, and tell them how you feel about the current situation and what we can do to make change.
So what I wanted to do was I watched the video, the discussion and the presentation between you and Dr. Herwig about this issue. I thought it was excellent. I really enjoyed it a lot. And I got so interested in it that I took notes. and I have some comments that I would like to make about my reaction to that. If you don't mind me just looking down at my notes here every once in a while.
No, please go ahead, please.
I think the key issue that needs to be emphasized that I totally agree with is that Huntington's disease is not just a motor disease. It is not just a movement disorder. It is so much more than that. It affects biologically, it affects probably the entire brain. And there are symptoms and signs that come from all parts of the brain. So although in neurology, it's often referred to as a movement disorder disease or a motor disease, it's so much more than that. Mental problems, cognitive problems, behavioral problems, psychiatric problems can be the most important factors that one has to deal with this disease, and they can overwhelm any movement or motor problem that the patient may have. In addition to that, I completely agree that these mental, cognitive, and behavior problems can come first. They can be the initial symptoms and signs of the disease, and they can present years before any kind of prominent motor disability. A specialist will argue back and forth if you see somebody with Huntington's and a behavior problem that on exam, maybe you'll find some subtle motor deficiencies, but that's not the key issue. The key issue is that the psychiatric and behavioral problems came first and are the most prominent. I have several examples of that happening in the chapters in my book that I think you both are familiar
yes.
with. I'd be happy to elaborate on some of those examples. I would also point out that this is not the only neurologic disease in which that's the case. There are many others where cognitive or behavioral problems come first and require criteria for the diagnosis. Examples of those are easy to come up with. Alzheimer's disease, for example, is a neurodegenerative disease. It can sometimes be genetic, and it's a cognitive problem that comes first. It's not a movement disorder or a motor disease. Frontotemporal dementia is another perfect example. In fact, it's similar to Huntington's in many ways. And they are behavioral and psychiatric problems that come first and are most prominent in the disease. And by the way, another one is schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is a brain disease. It's a biologic disease of the brain, and it's not a motor disease. It's not a movement disorder. It presents with behavioral, cognitive kinds of problems, and there have to be criteria for how you make the diagnosis, even though it's not always easy. Another point that I think is important to make is that when you're dealing with making the diagnosis and having diagnostic criteria, the CAG expansion testing is critical. You need that to be certain of the diagnosis. You have to combine that with the signs and symptoms that the patient is presenting with. If you don't have the CAG expansion, then you can't be certain of the diagnosis. So that really needs to be part and parcel of the diagnostic process. Another important piece of this story is that there are people who will benefit from the diagnosis. That is particularly the case in the United States, where Social Security, for example, and Social Security disability is completely dependent on the diagnosis and on a physician, usually a specialist, saying that in their professional opinion, that is the diagnosis and the person is disabled by that diagnosis. It also comes up in employment issues. And I have several examples of people, for example, who are about to be fired from their jobs for quote unquote incompetence, where in fact it was Huntington's disease and the behavioral and cognitive problems from the Huntington's disease that were causing their difficulties on the job. And it made a difference to them having that diagnosis rather than just being fired and losing all their benefits. They were sometimes moved to a different part of the institution where they could continue to work, but at a lower level, or they got a medical disability retirement, which allowed them to have benefits. So it made a huge difference in their life. So there are people who benefit from having the diagnosis. Even though, as we well know, there are people that do not want to have the diagnosis and they don't need the diagnosis, and you don't need to layer on this bad news when they don't need it and don't want it. So it's an individual kind of choice between the patient and the doctor. A couple of things that I wanted to be sure got discussed and were clarified. For example, I worry about the interpretation of the CAG repeat expansion numbers.
Mm-hmm.
It is true that an expansion of 27 to say 34, 35 repeats is abnormal. It's statistically abnormal. And there is a small possibility that that kind of expansion could get larger when it's passed on to the next generation, although the chances are actually quite small, that is possible. But I would be very cautious about concluding that an expansion in that very low but abnormal range is cause and effect for a patient's symptoms. If somebody comes to me with a family history of Huntington's and is having some personal problems or is acting a little bit strange, and they have an expansion number of say 29 or 30, I would not say that that's cause and effect. I think there are times when we have to say to patients, we don't know. There are times when the physician does not have the answer, and you sometimes have to wait and see. There are very few patients who have been documented in the literature of being symptomatic with repeat expansions in say 34, 35. They're very rare, they're very unusual, but no one has been proven that it's cause and effect when it's say it's 29, 30, 31. So I'd be very cautious about that. That range is abnormal statistically, but it's not necessarily a cause and effect. Another issue to be careful about is the availability of biomarkers. In my opinion, there is not any good biomarker that's readily available for Huntington's disease. It's true that neurofilament light is elevated and is it can be abnormal in both the spinal fluid and the plasma, but it's very nonspecific. It can be elevated in almost any brain disease. It's elevated in Parkinson's, it's elevated in ALS, it's elevated in Alzheimer's, and it can be elevated in head trauma, for example. So I'd be very cautious about using that. And I don't think there's any good biomarker for Huntington's disease other than following the atrophy on MRI, which unfortunately is late rather than early, or by in the research programs where they can follow the mutated protein in the spinal fluid, but that's only on a research basis. So unfortunately, there isn't a good biomarker. Another issue that has to be dealt with is that a lot of the behavioral problems that can be seen in Huntington's disease are admittedly nonspecific. The one that's the trickiest to deal with is depression. And I think depression is so common that I would not use that alone as a marker for Huntington's disease. If somebody at risk for Huntington's who even has a repeat expansion only has depression and nothing else, I wouldn't say that's necessarily cause and effect, because depression is so common, and certainly the depression needs to be treated. That's also true, unfortunately, of other behavioral things like atrophy and like poor judgment and violence and aggression, for example. They're common enough that a single episode of those could not be used to make the diagnosis of Huntington's. I think the real issue when it becomes to the behavioral problems is determining that it's a change. The family tells you that this is a real change from the way the individual used to be. And is it persistent? So if somebody has a single temper tantrum, that can happen to any of us. But if it's a person who was a well-behaved, calm, non-temper kind of individual, and they continue to have temper tantrums and inappropriate temper tantrums, and sometimes get violent, which is different from the way they behaved before, and they clearly have an abnormal CAG repeat expansion, that's a problem. And that could be a real clue to early Huntington's. I think one that's more likely to be true, but unfortunately it's fairly uncommon, is psychotic features. If people are having delusions and hallucinations, that's not common. And if you've got delusions and hallucinations and you've got an elevated CAG repeat expansion, that's probably an early sign of Huntington's. In fact, I've had several cases that have come to me and their diagnosis clinically by a psychiatrist was schizophrenia. And then they discovered that they had a family history of Huntington's. And sure enough, they had all the hallmarks of schizophrenia. They were having paranoid delusions. They were having auditory hallucinations. The devil was telling them to kill members of their family. But they had a repeat expansion of 45. And I had no doubt that that was an early sign of Huntington's disease. And the patient actually wanted to know, the family wanted to know, the psychiatrist wanted to know, and they were given the diagnosis on that basis. And they had no movement disorder at all, no motor signs whatsoever. So I've also had examples where, as I mentioned, people have done things showing really bizarre lack of judgment. You know, a real estate agent who suddenly told his family that he was going to apply to Harvard Law School because he wanted to go to Harvard Law School. And all he had was a high school education. He was a real estate agent. And then he goes out and wants to buy a boat that costs $40,000. And he has no money, no money at all. So they began, you know, signs of really poor judgment decisions in someone who wasn't doing that 10 years ago. And so again, I think that can very easily be an early sign of lack, cognitive problems and lack of good judgment that can tell you this is the beginning of Huntington's disease. So I think it does happen, but we do have to be cautious. We don't want to give people the diagnosis when they don't want it or don't need it. And there are times when we have to be willing to say, I don't know. We need to wait. Maybe more things will happen in the next 6 months or a year that will give us a better indication whether you're developing Huntington's or not. But the idea that they have to have a movement disorder, that they have to have chorea, is not correct. The mental and behavioral problems can begin early, and they can begin years before the motor disability. So those were my comments.
Wow. Wonderful. Wonderful. Excellent.
Yeah.
I couldn't agree more with you. Yeah. This is my 40-year experience as clinical scientist, and from the basic research that started 50 years ago, exactly. We don't have any biomarker that is 100% specific for Huntington's disease, except the CAG repeat. And there we are in the tricky spot that I can quote Jim Gozella. The numbers are still in the research, and there's no definite borderline between at 45 or 36, you are safe. No, you can be unlucky. And even with a 34 or a 33, you can have typical HD symptoms, both motor symptoms and cognitive or emotional symptoms. Very rare, we use stress that. That is a very, very rare incident, and you have to be very, very cautious as a physician, as a doctor, diagnosing that in that area. But the rest of your comments, perfect. That is so true what you said. We have to be very cautious about depression, because the spouse can be even more depressed than the person with the extension.
Yes, right.
And Dr. Bird, what I want to say first is that was a lot of good information in one setting, but most importantly, I'm glad you said it all, because although I would say the page in which this project lands on outlines it as simple as possible, but it's never simple unless we have these types of conversations, because we have said from the beginning, diagnosis is not for everyone. It should not be for everyone. That this is a specific initiative for those patients that you were describing who need not be turned away, but need that diagnosis for services and supports. So we have to take into account that there are people that they don't want to have a diagnosis. They want nothing to do with it. Let's be quite frank, I am a patient, and there are individuals in my circle that feel that way as well, and we respect that. But this project is specifically aimed to the individuals you were talking to, those who have, if they don't have overt motor symptoms, and they do indeed have the cognitive, psychiatric, behavioral, vegetative, or functional, that it should be looked upon seriously, especially if the CAG is of the mutated level. So I want to thank you, because you literally said everything that needed to be said. And I think, because Dr. Lang and I were talking yesterday and this morning about just a few questions we had, because we're blessed. A lot of organizations have joined the initiative. A lot of doctors have, and it's growing and it's growing. And a few questions we've had, you nailed it. You hit them right on the head. When we specifically put out that video and Dr. Lang and I worked on that pyramid, although it might seem elementary, our point that we wanted to put across is if in the event patient A has a CAG, well, the first thing is for them to visit the doctor if in the event that it is affecting them, have family support, if they have family history, and let the doctor have that conversation with them and see what is best for that patient, even if that patient does not have motor symptoms. You hit on it. They might want to, he went out and bought a car yesterday. We don't have the money. Dr. Bird, Dr. Lane, this is what we're hearing. This is what we're seeing on Facebook. So I want to thank you, Dr. Bird, for that, because that was a perfect piece of feedback.
Right. I think one of the things that happens to Dr. Lang and me is we get pushback from our colleagues. And for example, there are colleagues that say the behavioral and psychiatric presentation of Huntington's alone is very, very unusual. And when you really take a careful look at those people, you'll find some motor abnormality. They'll have hyperactive tendon reflexes, or maybe they'll have a couple of little twitches here and there. And what I say to that is, fine, that could be true, but that's not what they're complaining of. That's not their problem. They're not complaining of hyperactive tendon reflexes. They're complaining of paranoid delusions and Satan telling them to kill their wife. So the psychiatric and behavioral presentation is the big problem, and that's what's presenting. And if there's some minor motor findings, that's fine. That's acceptable. But that's not what you have to deal with. And another issue is, people are worried that if you come out with these behavioral criteria, that it will be sort of misused by general physicians, general practitioners, that they'll see someone with Huntington's, at risk for Huntington's, they won't have any experience with it, and they'll make an error. They'll tell them they have Huntington's when they really shouldn't be telling them that. And you know, the truth is that can happen. And so it's one of the reasons that I think as frequently as possible, the Huntington's families and patients should see physicians who are experienced with Huntington's disease. That's in our country, that's the whole reason there are these centers of excellence. And I know they're not available to everyone, but in today's world, certainly in the US, people can't be that far from a physician who is experienced with Huntington's. And that's who you need to see. Because of these tricky issues about interpreting the CAG expansion and interpreting behavioral and psychiatric manifestations, it takes someone with experience. And so that's important.
What we're also finding, though, Dr. Bird, agree with you wholeheartedly. For quite some time now, as patients, and we look to organizations for information and resources. We have algorithms that we give to our doctors. We have the PLOS algorithms. Many of us have educated our own primary care physicians. My entire family has. Although to your point, I get it, but there are instances, sadly, many more, where people are unable to get that connectivity with the centers of excellence, that they go onto social media, and we, as organizations, we always do say, yeah, you should try to connect with a center of excellence in your area. And if you can't, if you have a family doctor that you have been working with and seeing for years, here are documents that you could give to this doctor so that you can educate them. And the feedback that we've gotten over the years for that has shown and has proven to be helpful. So not going against your point, because your point is 100% accurate, but to give points, the HD community has been an amazing educator to doctors as well. So yes. I just wanted to say that.
Yes, I agree with that. And I've seen many instances where a family physician, an internist, for example, has done a very good job taking care and managing patients with Huntington's disease. No question about it. The only point I was making and that some of our colleagues make is the unfortunate exception where a Huntington's family runs into a physician who knows nothing about Huntington's and doesn't learn and makes uninformed, erroneous decisions. And right. That's unfortunate when that happens, but there's right. no question that a general physician can do just fine with the appropriate backup and knowledge. And as you say, a lot of that can come from the families.
But I think also the other part of this project that really hasn't been panned out or discussed, whatever verbiage you'd like to say, is God willing, and from what we've gathered from not only the patients and caregivers, but the lay organizations is, well, however this is going to pan out, we're hoping that there's going to be some type of universal educational pamphlet, digital online pamphlet, so that there's a standard that's easy for non-HD centers of excellence professionals. Because let's face it, if in the event that we could have our primary care physicians at a level in which they can, it will also alleviate a lot of the specialists, because if we put all the burden on the centers of excellence, it could be a troublesome thing also. So we have to get to that part of the project as well, is that once this comes to fruition, that there should be a standard of some sort, document, I don't know what it is, a mobile app, a piece of paper that everyone can use to give to their doctor to work in tandem with their specialist. That's at least my hope. Yeah. So I know we're running out of time, but
that's the way it should go.
Yeah. I know we're running out of time. Dr. Bird, what I would love for you to do is you kind of already have, I try to ask this of all the guests that come on the show. If you could take a moment and speak to the Huntington's community first and tell them how you feel about this project and your willingness to listen to them. And then on the other side of that, I'd like for you to speak to your colleagues and let them know, in your opinion, how important it is.
So the idea behind this, I think, is a good one and is important to emphasize. And it's, as I said at the beginning, the idea is that Huntington's disease is a general brain neurodegeneration that causes much more than a movement disorder. It frequently causes a cognitive, behavioral, and psychiatric problems. And they can be prominent, they can be most important, and they can be the initial symptoms of the disease. And that's something that has to be recognized and dealt with. It's not easy to deal with. They are very, very difficult problems, and they're tricky, but it's part and parcel of the disease, and it can't be ignored. And I say that to the patients, and I say that to my colleagues.
Fair enough. I completely agree with you. Dr. Bird, you are amazing. I can't wait to meet you in person. I love your book, truly do. And I wish that I could give it to everybody, but if you haven't gotten Dr. Bird's book, I'm putting it up right now so that you can actually see the book, and there'll be a link at the bottom.
It's a must to read for everybody, family and colleagues.
Yeah.
The doctor should read that book before they talk to any HD patient or family.
Agreed. I wanna thank you both. Dr. Bird, thanks again for always being there for the patients and caregivers. Always.
My pleasure. It's important.
Yes. And Dr. Lang, of course, you'll be on with me. We have upcoming shows with some amazing, your colleagues, Louise Vetter will be on, Deb Lovecki will be on. We're gonna have Seth Rotberg on, Dr. Cruikshank's gonna be on. So watch the space, and I wanna speak to all of you out there. If you are a patient and a caregiver, I wanna let you know, thank you for signing the petition. We're gonna put out numbers at the beginning of next month so that everyone could understand how important this is. It has been phenomenal. I wanna thank you as my fellow patient and caregiver, what you are doing to help support this global initiative. We will make change, and we have to thank God that we have medical professionals just like Dr. Lang and Dr. Bird in the trenches with us, and of course, other lay organizations who are now joining us. So please visit wehaveaface.org/change. The page has just been reformatted because there is so much information on there. So we tried to make it as easy to read as possible. You could upload your own video. You could watch videos. If you're an organization, you could join. If you want to sign the petition, you could sign the petition. I created a small little black and white PSA. We're over 10,000 views on that as it is. So if it wasn't for you, we would not be here. I love all of you. You're amazing warriors. I'll stop speaking because I'm an Italian. It's the problem I have. At any rate, thank you so much for watching our episode today. And always remember, you are loved.